The sun was getting higher where we left off in John chapter 19. The temperature was climbing. After the soldiers divided the clothing, there was the taunting. First, the leaders, the Pharisees, Sadducees, and scribes. Then the soldiers. Finally, even one of the two thieves hanging there on the cross beside Jesus. And just as the sun was reaching the top of its path, it went out. Just as if someone had turned off the switch, if they had switches back then. And for 3 hours, darkness came over the whole land. In Luke's account of the crucifixion, in chapter 23, verse 45, just before the darkness lifted, Jesus cried out, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." And with that, after 33 years on earth, 3+ years of public ministry, thousands of people fed, hundreds of miles walked, dozens of messages and parables and conversations, and countless healings and conversations on top of that, Jesus is dead. Given Luke's commitment to present an eyewitness account of Jesus' life and ministry, you would think he would have sought out the disciples to get their reactions to all that was going on. And what did Peter, James, and John, his inner circle, do when they learned that Jesus had died? How did the other 9 react? But they were nowhere to be found. Instead, starting in Luke 23, verse 50, we see the reactions of a complete stranger and some no-name women. You might call it the ancient equivalent of a nuclear blast. Jesus was dead and all of the regulars were gone. The sun returned, but make no mistake, it was the darkest day in history. Some of us don't have to try too terribly hard to imagine that. We've had our darkest day. Perhaps we're going through it right now. For others of us, this is something we've yet to experience. But rest assured, this day is probably coming at some time down the road. If you want proof of that, all you have to do is watch TV, watch the news for a couple of minutes. Everywhere we look, we see war, famine, unemployment, underemployment, cars break down, violence and crime, broken marriages, broken homes. This world is filled with bad stuff. It's a Good Friday kind of world in which we live. And yet, in the responses of this stranger and these no-name women, we find some essential observations, keys for life in a Good Friday world. In Luke 23, verses 50 and 51, we're introduced to a guy named Joseph. We're told by Luke that he's a man from Arimathea. Beyond that, though, we actually know almost nothing about him. And this is the first and the last time he appears in Scripture, to our knowledge. Now, there's some conjecture about where Arimathea is, but the truth is we don't even know where that is. So we don't even know where this guy comes from. We don't know who he is. All we really know is that he was a member of the council, the Sanhedrin, the group of Jewish leaders that kind of had autonomy over Jerusalem and the surrounding area. Luke tells us that Joseph was a good and righteous man. That's the other thing that we know about him. He had not agreed with the rest of the council's plan and decision, and not agreed with their decision and their action to crucify Jesus. Why didn't he agree? Well, because Luke tells us he was looking forward to the kingdom of God. In other words, Luke hints at what John makes clear. Joseph was a secret follower of Jesus. And so for months, Joseph had been following Jesus, but from a distance. I mean, he couldn't go where Jesus was for fear of people finding out. Right? But he went when he could, when he thought he could get away with it, whenever he could volunteer for the crew that went from the Sanhedrin, the Pharisees, Sadducees, and then whenever the crew went to spy on Jesus, he tried to volunteer, at least enough that it he could see what was going on, but not so many times that it seemed suspicious. The rest of the time he paid close attention as the reports came back, talking to the Sanhedrin about where Jesus had been, what he'd been doing, what he'd been saying. He also paid close attention to how the other council members were responding to Jesus. When Jesus arrived in Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, 5 days before the crucifixion, I imagine Joseph then was ecstatic. I mean, was this it? He'd been following the reports. He knew what was going on. Was the kingdom of God finally come? But then his colleagues confronted Jesus about the things the crowd was shouting. And you might remember they were shouting, "Blessed is the King, blessed is the King." They didn't like this notion that Jesus was their king. And Joseph just stood back and kept quiet. When Jesus threw the merchants out of the temple, he embarrassed the Sanhedrin. I imagine more than a few of them were piping and mad. But Joseph bit his tongue as they ranted and railed. And when Jesus criticized them directly and they resolved they were going to kill him, Joseph was alarmed. Don't get me wrong, but they had talked like this before. In fact, on numerous occasions, they had ranted and railed against Jesus and even plotted to kill him. Nothing had ever happened then, so Joseph said nothing now. But then very early Friday morning, news came to Joseph that they had arrested Jesus. From that moment, things become something of a blur. Maybe somebody on the council got wind that Joseph was sympathetic to Jesus, and so they didn't send for him in time to get to the trials. Maybe he hastily threw on some clothes and he raced across town to witness the trials, but when he saw how rabid the rest of the council was, how vitriolic they were against Jesus, he held his tongue again in fear. The truth is, we don't know exactly what happened. We know only that Luke tells us that Joseph disagreed with the plan in action, but Mark tells us that all of them condemned Jesus as deserving death. However this went down, as I read this passage in Luke chapter 23, I see a man with deeply profound regrets. Don't you think? You hear the stuff that he's a believer and he's following Jesus in secret, and he's on the council, so he could have been the one to step up and say, "No, let's not do this. This is a bad idea." And yet he didn't. So why didn't he say something? Why didn't he do something? Why didn't he follow Jesus when he had the chance? This man is full of regrets, and I dare say regret is a hallmark of the Good Friday world in which we live. I mean, let's face it, we're all familiar with regret, are we not? We did something we shouldn't have done, or we didn't do something we should have. We said the wrong thing, or we just didn't say the right thing. We could have, should have, and would have. This is so often our mantra. Yeah. In this Good Friday world, we have regrets. It's part of it. It's the way it is. We see something else in Joseph also. And yes, he had these regrets, but in verse 52, it was also Joseph who went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. And I got to tell you, this is a big deal. I mean, we've all heard of the saying that you're guilty by association, right? Maybe you've experienced it, right? As a teenager, you were hanging out with the not-so-awesome crowd, and everybody assumed that you were not-so-awesome because you were hanging with them. Or maybe you were the not-so-awesome crowd, and you got people in trouble because they were hanging out with you. I don't know, but we're all familiar with this idea of guilt by association. Crucifixion was reserved for the worst of the worst, the absolute enemies of the state. And typically, these bodies, after they were dead, they were allowed to hang on the cross for days so that their flesh would be picked away by animals and birds. That's how much these people were detested. And if anyone dared to come and claim the body before that could happen, it was assumed that they were sympathizers. They were guilty because they chose to associate with this person on the cross. And because they were guilty by association, they also could be nailed up on the next cross over. This is a courageous thing that Joseph did. Now granted, Joseph had the advantage of being a member of the Sanhedrin, so he could maybe hint that the council wanted him to have the body. And he could say, "No, I'm doing this because tomorrow is the Sabbath and the Passover is here and we don't want bodies left on the crosses and that kind of stuff." And he could make up a pretty good excuse, but he was still pretty risky. I mean, when somebody rat him out, would he be crucified as well? Was a pretty courageous thing for him to do, really, to go to Pilate and to ask for the body. But Joseph didn't stop there, did he? If you're familiar with the story in Luke 23, verse 53, he took the body down, he wrapped it in linen cloth, and he laid it in his own brand new tomb. I mean, it was one thing to take the body down and bury it hastily in a potter's field, a community tomb for people who were poor or criminals, that kind of thing. That would have been one thing, but no, he took him and put him in his own tomb, the one that he had paid money for. It's pretty hard to say you don't sympathize with someone when you're paying for their grave or you're giving up your grave for them to use. So yeah, this is a pretty courageous thing for Joseph to do. You know, we often mistake courage for the lack of fear. But the truth is, courage is more accurately defined as a resolve to do the right thing, even if it's scary. In the Old Testament, courage was a prominent theme. The word appears 98 times in the Holman Christian Standard Bible. And just this past week, our governor honored people from across our state who demonstrated courage and became heroes in moments of need. And every one of these situations had something in common. Something scary needed to be done to correct something that was wrong. And one or two people, maybe a small handful, stood up to get it done. And the thing is, courage wasn't something that God just handed out. In Joshua chapter 1, God commanded Joshua to be strong and courageous. And the implication of God giving Joshua that command is that courage was Joshua's responsibility. Courage is our responsibility. And I got to say, if we're going to live in a Good Friday world, we're going to need courage. It's not that we're not afraid, because we may very well be. Rather, it's that despite our fear, we are committed to doing the right thing, no matter what. At this point in Luke's narrative, the spotlight shifts off of Joseph, and he kind of fades into the shadows, not just of Scripture, but of history. We never see him again. He doesn't come back. Instead, the spotlight shifts from this unknown stranger to a group of unnamed women. Luke doesn't give us their names, but he does give us one crucial bit of information about them. He says they had come with Jesus from Galilee. In other words, they had been following Jesus for months, maybe longer. And everywhere Jesus went, he did miracles, right? He healed the sick, he fixed the lame, he made the blind see, he drove out demons. He was doing all these miracles all the time. And he was teaching as well, right? Everywhere he went, he's having conversations with people, delivering parables and little messages and vignettes and things like that. And these women, they've been following him. They've been witnessing these miracles. They've been hanging on his every single word. It also means that they've been among the crowd on Palm Sunday. You know, the throng of people surrounding Jesus, following through the streets. The ones that were waving the palm branches and dropping their cloaks. The ones that were shouting at the top of their voices, Hosanna, and blessed is the King. They had expected Jesus to save Israel from the Roman oppressors. They had expected Jesus to be crowned King. Instead, in verse 55 of Luke chapter 23, they followed along and observed the tomb, and how his body was placed. I don't know about you guys, but that's what I would call disappointment. I mean, right? You got an expectation, and you got reality. There's a huge gap in between them. They didn't get what they expected. They were disappointed. And I got to say, disappointment isn't an inescapable part of living in a Good Friday world. We have disappointment. It's a fact of life, isn't it? When we expected that new job, the perfect spouse, the cute and cuddly children, right? Instead, we get a rejection letter. He leaves his dirty socks in the middle of the bedroom floor, and she's a terrible cook. And children? All right, my kid's sitting here, but I'm going to tell you the truth. Ready? Truth is, kids aren't nearly as cute and cuddly at 2 a.m. when they're screaming their heads off, are they? And when you're changing that diaper that exploded all over everything, cute and cuddly they are not. Well, it's funny when you do it. No, no, it's not. Now, some of this disappointment may be the result of ill will. Now, there are people that are out to get us every now and then. That's true. I'm sorry about that, but it's the way it is in a Good Friday world. But it's also true that disappointment just happens. Regardless of our best efforts, we still fall short. And there's disappointment that comes with that. I mean, think about this for a second. Jesus warned his disciples that all this was going to happen, right? I mean, he point blank said, I'm going to Jerusalem, they're going to arrest me, they're going to beat me, they're going to hang me on the cross, and I'm going to die. And still, they got their hopes up. Still, they were disappointed. Truth is, in a Good Friday world, we have disappointment. But it was even worse than that. In Luke 23, verse 54, we discover that Jesus died on Preparation Day. That is, he died on Friday. And more specifically, he died about 3 o'clock in the afternoon on Friday. So by the time all the paperwork was filled out and Jesus' body was released, it was even later. The shadows were starting to grow, right? I mean, that's what we've got going on here, isn't it? And it's important that we recognize that because the Jews counted their days from sunset to sunset. And they called Friday the preparation day because at sunset on Friday, that's when the Sabbath began. And in Jewish culture, on the Sabbath day, as soon as it began, all of the shops in town were going to shut down. No work could be done. The end. In other words, despite Joseph's best efforts, there wasn't time to give Jesus a proper burial. So in verse 56, we discover what may be the most unsatisfying ending of any story ever in history, right? Luke tells us that then the women returned and prepared spices and perfumes, and they rested on the Sabbath according to the command. I mean, talk about bleak, right? It doesn't get much more bleak than this, I think. Ken here in his commentary on Luke observed, quote, "It is hard to look at the events of this day and see the hand of God in them. Evil men had their way with the Son of God. The one who promised life died. The life of the king was brutally ended before he could come into his kingdom. There was nothing left to do by those who believed in him but to complete his burial. And by doing so, they would bury their hopes for a redeemer." Now, sometimes in a Good Friday world, all hope seems lost. We find ourselves alone in the dark, and it seems as though there is no light anywhere to be found, much less at the end of the tunnel. It's a good thing then that this wasn't the end of the story. I mean, Luke doesn't stop with Luke 23:56. And in fact, as we turn the page, the very first word of Luke chapter 24 is huge. It's the word "but." And I know it's just three letters and it doesn't seem all that big of a deal here and now, but the truth is, "but" marked something was about to change. And that something was huge. Now it's easy for us to say 2,000 years later, after the fact, it's easy for us to say, okay, but yeah, Jesus is going to come back from the grave, and that's all well and good. But in that moment, the hopelessness of these women, man, it was undeniably real. In that moment, the hopelessness of our Good Friday can be overwhelming. In that moment, when all hope seems lost, the good news of Good Friday, the only reason we can call it good at all is that this wasn't the end. And as dark as this Good Friday world may be, as dark as it may seem as we go through this Good Friday kind of life, we who believe in Jesus yet have that hope. The hope that on Sunday morning, there was a big fat but. The stone was rolled away. The tomb was empty. Because Good Friday wasn't the end. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we are so grateful that Good Friday wasn't the end. May you help us live that way today. As dark as things may be today or tomorrow or next week or next year, as long as it might take, may you remind us always that in your kingdom there is a but. And what seems like it might be the end, what seems like it may be the hopelessness of Good Friday, gives way to the empty tomb of Easter Sunday. May you remind us always, Lord, that is, as H.M. Lockridge said in his famous sermon, "It's Friday, but Sunday's coming."